Hi. Starting in the early 1990s, technology companies in particular, and young growth companies in general, started to use options to compensate employees. They did it for two reasons. One was there was a misguided attempt in Congress to keep a cap on employee compensation, and the cap was written in such a way that options were not considered as part of compensation. So companies went around the cap by issuing options. The other is a much more economic rationale, which is if you're a young growth company, you don't have the cash to pay employees what they might deserve, you pay in options. Now that by itself is not a problem. There's nothing wrong with companies paying employees with options. But if you're valuing a company and there are options outstanding on that company that they've issued to their employees, it does reduce your value per share. And in fact, today what I want to talk about is how to incorporate the overhang, the option overhang, on your value per share for equity. So I'm going to use a company that has been a very liberal user of options for the last two decades, Cisco, to illustrate how to bring in the value of options into your analysis. So let's say you're valuing Cisco. So you do a traditional discounted cash flow valuation, right? You take the revenues, you subtract out the operating expenses, you subtract taxes and reinvestment to come up with free cash flows of the firm that you discount back at the cost of capital. So let's say you've done all of that stuff right. You come up with a value for the business, you've subtracted out the debt, you come up with a value of equity in Cisco as a company. Here's where you need to pause. That equity has two claims on it. One is your claim and my claim as common stockholders in the company. The other is the claim of the option holders in the company. So if you're looking at what's my share worth as a common stockholder, you have to subtract out the value of the options outstanding in the company from the value of the equity before you divide by the number of shares. So when you value a company like Cisco, or in fact, any company with options outstanding, go through the 10K or annual report looking for details about options that are still outstanding. The case of Cisco, you get to page on the most recent 10K, which is the 10K ending the end of September of 2012. You get to page 124, 125, 126. You start to see a listing of how Cisco uses stock to compensate employees. I'm going to skip through the first couple of pages for the moment because it's the details of how they've given grants, and turn to this page, which is page 126, where they tell you about the options that are already outstanding. Note that these are not expectations of what will happen in the future. These are options that are already outstanding. In the case of Cisco, here's what it looks like. At the end of September of 2012, there are 520 million options outstanding. So you see that list number listed there? Out of the 520 million, about 8 million are not vested yet, in the sense that the employees haven't been around yet to be entitled to the options. But I'm going to stay with the 520 million options. And in this table, Cisco also provides some useful information. In fact, most companies do. They give you a weighted average exercise price and a weighted maturity for the options. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to open up an Excel spreadsheet on the side where I can value these options so you can see the numbers go directly from the Cisco 10K into the spreadsheet. So the first number it asks you for is the current stock price. Let's hold off on that because that's not going to be in the 10K. The 10K is old. So I'm going to take the numbers that are in the 10K. First number I pull up is the exercise price. I'm going to use the weighted average exercise price. I'm cheating because I should be valuing each sliver of options separately. But I think this is good enough. Take the entire set of options, take the weighted average exercise price. You might wonder why I'm not just taking the exercisable options. To me, it doesn't matter whether the options are exercisable or not. As long as options are live, they're value. So I'm going to take into account all options. And in the case of Cisco, the weighted average exercise price is $22.68, and you see that as my strike price for the option. For the expiration of the option, I'm going to take the weighted average maturity, 2.53 years, and enter that as my maturity. For the standard deviation, there are a couple of things I can do. One is I can go look up that standard deviation for Cisco on some data service. For instance, I have access to Bloomberg or Capital IQ, and they have 2 years standard deviations on Cisco. I can pull that up. I can even use listed options on Cisco to get an implied standard deviation. I'm actually going to cheat in this case and use a number that's far easier to get. If you look at Cisco's own 10K, they give you an estimate of what their expected volatility is. I know they could be cheating, but it saves me the trouble. And they say their standard deviation is 30.5%. I'm going to enter that in as the standard deviation. I can always double check that number to make sure they aren't lying and understating their volatility. I also pulled up the numbers, the other numbers right off this table. And again, I'm doing this to save myself some time. The first is the dividend yield. And the dividend yield that Cisco reports for themselves is 1.5%. I enter that as the dividend yield. That's easily checkable. I can look at their actual dividend yield, and I will. Okay. I also look up a risk-free rate. And here again, I should be able to get this number. And Cisco claims that the risk-free rate they used was 2.3%. That sounds a little high for a 2.5-year option, especially at today's stable rates. So I'm actually going to enter 1% as my risk-free rate. The risk-free rate should reflect the maturity of your option, should be the current risk-free rate for that maturity. Right now, a 2.5-year treasury is not carrying a 2.3% risk-free rate. So I'm going to use 1% as my risk-free rate. Then there's a final key input, which is the number of options outstanding, which is from the previous table, 520. And again, as I emphasize, I'm going to count all options, not just the vested options, not just the exercisable options. I'm almost home free. I need two numbers I need to update. I need the stock price for Cisco, and I need the number of shares outstanding. For those, here's what I did. I went to Yahoo Finance or Google Finance or some other database that's updated to get the, because I want a price that's a current price. I don't want the price as of September 30th. I'm valuing the options as of today. The stock price for Cisco when I did this was $20.90. That's right up there, 2090. And the number of shares outstanding are also on the same page. If you go down a little bit, 5.33 billion. I entered 5,330 million is the number of shares outstanding. That's pretty much the raw data that I need. Then I ask you a few questions to clarify how to value these options. First, the 2.53 years is the stated maturity of the options, but employee options tend to be illiquid. They tend to get exercised early. So in most cases, when you value these options, if you use the stated maturity, you're going to overvalue these options. So I give you a chance to fix that if need be. You say, do you want me to change that? And if you say yes, that you want me to change the maturity, then you should enter a number lower than 2.5. Don't enter a number higher than 2.53. That would make no sense. But studies indicate that options get exercised, employee options get exercised about halfway through the regular life. So in this case, if you wanted to enter 1.5, I'd value the options with a 1.5-year maturity. In the case of Cisco, I didn't take advantage of that choice. And here's why. The options are out of the money for the most part. Right? Stock price is actually lower than the strike price. So I don't think there's going to be a rush of employees trying to exercise their options. Be different if the stock price was 200 and the exercise price was 20. So I've left this at no. Then I ask you, do you want me to adjust the value of the options for taxes? But what I mean by that is when employees exercise their options, the company is allowed to claim as a tax deduction the difference between the stock price and the strike price, which effectively makes the option value a tax deductible number. If you say yes, then I need a tax rate, so enter the tax rate. And there's a final question I ask. You're not a big deal for Cisco, where most of the options are in fact vested and exercisable, but if you have a young company, it could turn out that half the options are not vested yet, and there's a chance that they might never get vested. So if you want to adjust for that value, just enter yes, and tell me what percentage or what likelihood there is that these options will get exercised. I would enter a really high number because often these options are concentrated in a few hands and those guys hang around long enough to make sure that they get vested. So if in doubt, just leave this at no so that I can value the options. So I have pretty much all the inputs I need. So let's go through and ignore the phone ringing in the background. Let's go through and value the options. So you've got the stock price, you've got the strike price. Let me go through what I'm going to do here. See the stock price of $20.90? Because exercising these options will lead to more shares being outstanding, and exercising the options, you're going to exercise at a price lower than the stock price. There's going to be dilution. So the price that you see there of $19.25, that's actually my dilution adjusted value stock price. What I'm effectively saying is if you try to exercise these options today, you're going to push down the stock price. How am I estimating that? Here's what I do. I take the current stock price, 2090. I take the current number of shares outstanding, 5,330 million. To that, I add the value of the options outstanding, which is going to be 520 million times the value that I get for the options right here. Okay? I know you're already saying that that's going to be circular. It's exactly right. There is going to be circular reasoning, which is part of the reason. If you look at my preferences, and this should be preset for you, but make sure it is preset. you'll notice there's a check on the iteration box to make sure that the circularity will work. So what this spreadsheet will do is it'll take your estimated value of options to adjust the stock price and keep doing it until it converges. The strike price remains unchanged, so I enter the strike price. The maturity, because I didn't adjust it, stays at the stated maturity. And I go through the rest of the inputs, number of options outstanding, shares outstanding, T-bond rate, variance. Basically, the variance is the standard deviation, 30.5 squared, etc. And the rest is pretty straightforward. I value the options, and this is a dilution-adjusted value. I value per option 236 multiplied by 520. That gives me my pre-tax value. Because I wanted the options to be adjusted for taxes, I multiply by 1 minus the tax rate. I've got the after-tax value. If I want to adjust for vesting, I also multiply that number by the likelihood of vesting. So if I had said yes to the vesting question and said entered 90%, only 90% of the value would have been counted here. Now you're saying, what am I going to do with this bottom line number, the 906 million? Here's how it's going to play out. Once I get a discounted cash flow value for the equity in Cisco, I'm going to subtract out the 906 million, which is the value of the options, from it. And once I've subtracted out, I'm going to divide by the actual number of shares outstanding today, the 5,330 million that I have as a shares outstanding today. Not the fully diluted, which will be 5,850, but I'm going to actually use the actual number of shares, because if I use the fully diluted, I'd be double counting. But to do this process right, you have to dig up the details about the options outstanding, and you have to factor that into the value per share. So the more options your company has outstanding as a percentage of outstanding shares, and the more in the money those options are, and the longer the maturity of the options, the greater the effect you will see on your value per share. So in summary, if you have a company with options outstanding, employee options outstanding, don't ignore them, because there's going to be a deadweight cost associated with those options that reduce your value of equity. One other point about Cisco that's worth emphasizing. Cisco is not done granting options. In fact, it continues to give options every year. And here's one of the interesting things that companies in the US have had to do for the last few years. When you grant options now, you now have to value those options as options and show them as part of your expenses this year. In the case of Cisco, if you look at their most recent 10K, they actually had $1.2 billion of expenses associated with the use of options that are already reducing their operating income. So you don't have to do anything. It's already built into your operating income. Your operating income for Cisco is already lower because they grant options. Pre-2007, you'd have had to do this yourself, because this practice is relatively recent. So what this will do, if you expect them to keep granting options, lower your expected operating income and cash flows in future years, which will also lower your present value. It sounds like a double whammy, but it is a double whammy, because you're going to be hurt twice. Once, because you've already granted options and they're a deadweight cost for you as a stockholder. And second, if you continue to grant options, there's less income and cash flows available to your equity investors. So that's pretty much it. So if you get a chance, pick up a company that has options outstanding and see if you can work out the effect of the value of the options on your value per share. You're saying, what if my company grants restricted stock, which actually has become the preferred mode of compensation? Then you have far fewer prompts. Restricted shares are very much like any other shares. You don't have to do this kind of stuff to adjust for anything, because they're already counted in the number of shares outstanding. That's about it. Thank you very much for listening.